Welp, come to Mushroom Land.
No. That is not this channel. Yeah. Nathan, come on now.
What,
come on.
What are you, in the Matrix?
Yeah, you're Mush Tomb. Anyway, yeah, these stupid back. Trust me, this background is better than the background that's behind me. It's just a garage. I'm in a garage, so I thank you, Discord, for making it seem like it's a little... Yeah, this is better than just blurring it. So anyways, Nathan, we are doing... What's this album called? I don't even know how to pronounce it.
Omnium Gatherum.
Oh, Gatherum. Okay, I couldn't read that. I thought it said Gadherum or Gatherum. Okay, Gatherum. Okay. Omnium Gatherum. That's cool. Font there. You'd almost think, if you've seen this album for the first time, that that's the name of the band. Like, if you were to see this on a record shelf, you'd think, oh, it's Omnium and the album's Gatherum, you know what I mean? Because it's just really small lettering up there. King Gizzard, Lizard Wizard. Okay.
Yeah.
So we're going to do, this is part one of the album. It's a pretty long album. It's 80 minutes long. However, we've already done the Dripping Tap. So before people add us in the comments, yes, we've already done the Dripping Tap. We loved it. If you want to see a reaction to that song, by all means, just
it's Google. Going up right here on the video right now as you say that.
Boom. You're just creating more edit work for yourself, Nathan.
Yeah, it's easy but, to do.
Okay. All right. So we're going to start with
Magenta.
Thank you. I'm not going to be able to pronounce anything from this album, I think. mixed reviews from the review scores there, Nathan. I haven't read the reasons why, but sort of mixed. Some high, some low. The lowest are halfway, like, All Music, you know, gave it 2.5 out of 5 stars.
Ooh.
Loud and Quiet gave it 5 out of 10 stars. But then, Mojo gave it 3 out of 5. Record Collector gave it 3 out of 5.
Mm-hmm.
The top scores were 9 out of 10 from Clash, 7 out of 10 from Gigwise, and then, of course, 5 out of 5 from Louder Than War. So those are the professional ratings. Have you heard how fans think about this album?
I'm just going off of what our Discord community, because it's not like we took a hiatus. We're just kind of not, monkeys that do what everyone tells us to do anymore. So
that's true to me. Yeah, we do what we want when we want. This is no one paid for this. This is not a Patreon request. This is not a PayPal payment. There's no pledge. This is free.
And
we're doing this because we want to do this. And we'll get to it when we get to it. That's what Nathan's. Yeah.
And so because I've been seeing the comments come up in our Discord about like, oh man, you guys got to get some ears on this. I've been like not listening to it and wanting to so bad. So this is partly my, come on, let's do this, Ryan. And so if it's bad, it's my fault.
No, everything's fine. And I also want to say, this is their latest album. You know, we have done so much King Gizzard. It's kind of cool to be kind of on track.
Yeah.
So we haven't done Made in Timeland yet. We have not done that album. We are going to do that album. Mm-hmm. Nathan was just particular. He just was particularly excited to do this one for whatever reason. The last full album we did was Butterfly 3000. Is that available on YouTube or did that get blocked? I can't remember.
It's like partially available. Yeah, I think it's there. Okay. Yep.
If it's blocked in your region, you can join our Patreon and see it there.
Mm-hmm.
All of our stuff, everything we've ever done is available on Patreon, ad-free. But Butterfly 3000, Nathan, left kind of a blah taste in my mouth. I think I enjoyed Lizard Wizard or LW much more.
Mm-hmm.
But Butterfly 3000, I kind of felt, and I hate that I felt that way because I don't mind that kind of music that they played on that album, like that genre of sound.
Yeah.
But I felt not as Gizzard-y as I usually do when I listen to them. Mm. So I'm hoping Omnium Gatherum changes that for us.
Well, I know we both definitely liked the first track on this album already when we did
that. Yes, we did. We loved the spoiler alert. You know, maybe people haven't seen a reaction to that.
Right? Oh, sorry. You'll have to figure it out.
No, that's fine. No,
we enjoyed it. So I hope that's kind of like the flavor of the album.
Yeah, and just a reminder to those in our Discord, don't comment on the songs that are coming up, what they might be. Are they metal? Are they pop? Are they country? Are they whatever? Let us listen to it first so we can go into it kind of blind, okay? All right. Yeah. And, okay, so here we go. Magenta Mountain.
Hey, you got it right. You got it right.
Yeah, I learn.
Probably Ambrose playing that.
For sure. So who's the two people singing here?
It's a harmony, yeah.
So that's Stu and Joey singing together. Yeah. Okay. And Ambrose the singing at the beginning, I would.
That's a cool little motif there. I love it.
Ambrose singing very, very high.
Yeah.
Like a female voice.
Yeah. Yeah, sure. Ah. So, first thoughts. This has echoes of Butterfly 3000 to me. There's parts of this that remind me of Butterfly. And as far as a song goes, like, I absolutely imagined riding my one wheel listening to that. So that's going on the one wheel.
I know you're going to.
It's going on the one wheel playlist.
You and your one wheel. I knew that was going to be a. That's good. I was going to ask you if it was going to be. Yeah.
Yeah, because it feels like a riding song. Like, it's just, you know, I'm not a, I don't do tricks on my one wheel. I'm not that kind of person.
Hey, the fact that you could drive a one wheel is a trick, right?
Yeah, it's already an accomplishment, and I've fallen off of it three times and been injured. But it's the kind of song that goes with it really well, so it's going on there. Yeah, there you go. That's a high praise.
Awesome. Yeah. Somebody in our Discord chat, I don't know if you can see the Discord chat while you're recording. Okay, so Nathan doesn't see the Discord chat, so that came from him saying that it sounded like a butterfly, like, feeling to it. And somebody did say that that was a leftover, so to speak, or carryover song. From. Now, let me say this. That song was better than pretty much any song on that album. So, that song maybe should have... I don't know what the... See, that was a great, great sound. I think... That sound with that song, with the what they were going for in Butterfly, I feel like they perfected with this song.
Mm.
A very heavy bass line, danceability to it. I love the three-way vocal. That's just I love that. Yeah. And I should have called that it was Joey. I was 90% sure it was Joey singing. Stu was very quiet on it. Mm-hmm. So definitely the Joey was coming through more, and I was just too nervous to be wrong. So, but I was pretty sure it was Joey singing that second part, and so that was really cool. I hope we get more tri-vocal Fector stuff, so that's cool, or more Joey singing on this album.
Yeah, so and Joey didn't write it. Sometimes Joey sings on only the songs that he writes, and he didn't write this one, so interesting.
Well, no, apparently he was a co-writer, according to Wikipedia.
Oh, okay.
But maybe not according to iTunes. So, iTunes but Wikipedia says, yeah, I know. So I think you're right, Nathan. I would almost lean towards Wikipedia being more right than iTunes.
Okay. Yeah, no, that. It's been correct in the past. So.
Yeah. So the next song, so anyways, people are saying it wasn't cut from the album. Okay, our apologies, but it's certainly a child of that sound. Let's put it that way. So I that's what leads me to believe they perfected. Maybe they were like, you know what? We can make that sound better. And they did. I think that song was proof that, yeah. All right. So yeah, I loved it. It was a great song. This is off to a great start, this album, with these, you know, the first two tracks on this album, the first one, the 18-minute one, and now this one is a great start. Mm-hmm. So now we're about to do Kepler. This one here, Nathan, was written by Craig McKenzie and a guy named Barney McCall. He's a jazz piano player and composer.
So Craig McKenzie must be related to Stu somehow.
No, this individual. No, sorry. Craig is the last name. I just going by the last name. Sorry. Cook Craig is a guitar player. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, Stu McKenzie, Cook Craig, and Barney McCall. So he is a jazz piano guy. He was born in 66, but his genre is jazz. So let's... Didn't they do a jazz-like album?
There was that one that we didn't like that much.
What was that one?
They were the Mile High Club or whatever. The
Sketches of Brunswick. Yeah. Sketches of Brunswick East. Yeah. Ooh. Oof. that was a bit of a I appreciate that they do different stuff. I think that's great. That was just a bit of a oof.
Yeah. Okay, let's hopefully this one isn't an oof.
Yeah, we were just called hosers for that. I don't care. That's fine. Got that the props of probably Barney on the piano right there. That jazz now. Bass is really in the forefront on this album. More.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Different drum beat,
yeah,
than they've normally used. horns in it too.
I'll start this one.
Okay.
So Cook Craig, now I went to the personnel of the album, and people have to remind me, I admit, when it comes to the non-Stew and Ambrose, I get a little bit, you know, I forget the names of everyone. I know they're all multi-talented, multi-instrumentals. Did they not have a bass player who was like the bass player? Because I'm a little confused here, because Lucas Harwood, he plays the bass, according to Wikipedia, only on the first track. Oh. And that name sounds familiar. He sounds like, I thought he was in the band. And is there a reason why he's... Anyway, so Cook Craig played bass on this song.
I feel like Cook Craig has played on a lot of their stuff, I feel like.
You know, Cook Craig, it does. I think on this album, he does guitars on tracks 1, 2, 7, 10, vocals on 1 and 8, synthesizer on multiple, keyboards on multiple. Like, they're really sharing a lot of duties here. But particularly I was listening to the bass player. I was, oh, I want to get the bass player's name, but it was Craig, and Lucas only does bass on one track on this recording. Is there a reason why he'd only do the one track? Is he just kind of a session guy or something, or yeah. Anyways, all that being said, I was actually pleasantly surprised by the song. I was a little bit nervous when I saw that they had a guest jazz artist. I was like, you know, are we gonna get more sketches going on? But it was fun. It was very low key singing by Stew, like that.
Very like almost what's it called, breathy singing, very like calming. It's the kind of jazz I like. It's that it's not called electronic jazz, I hate that term, but it's not old school jazz where like, you know what I mean, like the slow beat, and you know, I don't mind that. I've listened to a lot of that lounge jazz. That's what I was trying to think. It's not lounge jazz, it's kind of got an upbeat pace, and I like that. I prefer that kind of jazz.
It was a nice song, and I was a little bit nervous, so I was pleasantly surprised about how much I did enjoy it. Because you know how some jazz can get complicated or just keep moving forward. King Gizzard did their Gizzard here. They did their Gizzardness. It had a nice little fun little kept going. That little beat kept going.
It was so Gizzardy.
And again, the bass playing by Craig. Great bass.
Solid.
Line.
Yeah.
Now. Let's get it now. Gaia, we've heard. Okay, I'm really excited.
Oh, right. Right.
Yeah. Oh, we've only heard not the studio. So with the Dripping Tap, yes, we've heard the studio version. We don't need to react to that again. We have not heard the studio version to Gaia. We saw a cell phone recording of a live performance a couple months back, and I remember thinking, I can't wait to hear the studio sound of this. I'm legit. Okay, I'm just like, I take a deep breath because I've been waiting for the studio version of this song for so long.
Yeah.
It was so amazing. I love heavy metal and heavy rock and roll. And the cell phone footage that I saw seems to me, okay. Well.
Okay. All right. Ready?
Cool.
Here it goes.
Yeah. We'll be right back.
Before it leads in. Yeah.
I'll let you start this one.
Okay. That's okay, I'll say this. That's King Gizzard at their best, I would say. And for two reasons. Number one, that one has a solo in it.
Are you gonna take all my talking points? I should have gone first. No. Keep going.
It has a solo, and I don't think you would say, you wouldn't bring this up. It's that it there's a complex beat there. And I think I brought this up in the live when we reacted to this live, that it's not just a standard 4/4 beat classic metal song. It's got a very complex beat. It's King Gizzard still using some of those elements of metal, but it's their own song, which makes it them at their best. That's what I love about King Gizzard, is they can take almost any genre and go, let's make King Gizzard's version of this genre, and then they put it out there, and it's amazing. So that's what I have to say.
No, it's great. You have a great ear for that, Nathan. Again, Nathan cannot see the Discord chat. Someone mushroomed to tell us in our Discord chat that, yeah, it's a 5/4 beat.
Yeah.
Is that right? Does that sound right?
I was trying to figure the beat out, and I love it when it's hard to figure out, because it makes me go like, I like this, but I can't figure out why. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know that stuff, or 9/8 or whatever. It doesn't matter. Anyways, the point is you have a good ear for that. And I know that I'm feeling that, but I can't explain. Like, I wouldn't be able to say, you know, the beat's different. You know, this is what it does for me. I'm nervous now. I almost want to stop the recording, take a break, because I hate this. I hate it when the song is so good. It was so much fun on a first time listen, and we still have like 30 songs to get through. And it makes me nervous. Like, are they going to top this? Is that the best song on the album? You know, did they blow their load on track 5 or whatever? It makes me. Anyways, I loved it. This is why I hate and love this song, for what I just said, because it's frustrating that this isn't the metal album that we thought. It was rumors, not King Gizzard's fault. But when I heard this live, and we thought at that time this metal album was coming, I was so giddy. And I was like, a whole album? Like Rat's Nest Part 2, you know?
Yeah.
And I when they do this, they do it so well. I think they're able to tap into that metal sound and performance, the growling vocals, or the they're able to do it so well that it's frustrating. They just don't do another album. They have 30 albums. Give me another one of just another metal album. Anyway, so I'm disappointed that selfishly that I'm not going to get more. That's all. But it doesn't mean the songs aren't good. But that it taps into my wheelhouse very heavily. No pun intended. Yes.
I would guess, based on just that particular song, that they're not going to just leave metal alone. it'll
we got here.
Yeah. Sorry, go ahead.
Oh, sorry. Poodle Slayer Discord said that Stu did say he does want to do another Rat's Nest type album. So he obviously, Stu listens to my channel, our channel.
Yeah, clearly.
Well, we are the number one King Gizzard channel. There's no doubt about it. So
we definitely have the most reactions.
We're more popular than King Gizzard, actually. King Gizzard is actually making albums just so for us to react to. They actually are doing that for us. They're actually, like, they're answering our requests.
which is why so many of our videos get blocked every time we put them up. So
that's right. All right. So what's the next one, Nathan? It is called
Ambergris.
Yep. Ambergris. Before you hit play, this is a Walker song. So I would assume Joey Walker, your favorite Gizzard member. I bet you he'll be singing, and we'll get some interesting guitar work. We'll see.
Cool.
Yeah.
It's a funky bass. Kind of sound there.
Like Think again.
I've Faith No More.
No, but Faith No More is copying. Good call, the vocal. No, Prince. The Prince song.
Sure. Yeah. Commodores a little bit.
Yeah, Commodores and Prince. Yeah.
Went full 70s on this one.
Yeah.
Go ahead first.
Okay. All right. This is where we are honest, because I know people listen to our channel because I think they like us. I think because we're fair and honest, at least with our opinions. Doesn't mean we're right.
Mm-hmm.
This is a song where, yeah, I recognize the talent. This is a situation where I can recognize the talent of what's happening. I get it.
Mm-hmm.
I know you're talented. I understand it. I find it interesting that they delve into this type of sounds. That's great.
Mm-hmm.
But if this was a King Gizzard sound, let's just pretend this is the first song you ever showed me from King Gizzard. Let's just pretend, yeah, for whatever reason, hey, I want to show you my favorite band, King Gizzard, and you played that one for me.
Mm-hmm.
I'd be like, I'm cool. That's cool.
Yeah.
Enjoy your band. You know, enjoy your band.
Yeah.
This is a song that you can listen to if you're a King Gizzard fan, mm-hmm, and you know the cut of their jib.
Mm-hmm.
But this is not a song you're showing anybody for the first time.
Yeah.
So that being said, but at the same time, it's like I can't drive to this. I can't jog to it. It's sure.
I know why it's on this album. Yeah, I think if you're a fan of the band, like you say, you know why this song is on this album, because it doesn't really fit anywhere else, and it's a Joey song. That's another thing, right? So it's got Joey tends to have a very funky sound to his music. So there's that funk that's there, but it, like sure, you say, it's certainly not one of Joey's best. I did like that there was kind of a little attempt at a little solo there at the end. And yeah, there was things that I liked about it, but I generally agree with what you said. It's, it's not the type of song that you'd go and be like, okay, here's a King Gizzard song. But then, having said that, if you were trying to show somebody, like, who's King Gizzard, I would absolutely put this song on a list of songs to say, like, well, they're this. Let me show you. They're metal. They're pop. They're whatever this is, funk, kind of 70s funk. Like, on a list of songs, it does kind of outline what they're like in that they've, you know, experimented with this genre. So that's the only reason I would put it on any list, is to give the bigger picture.
Interesting. That's an interesting spin. All right. I like it. No, I know what you're saying, but yeah. All right.
Sadie Sorceress.
So with a title like that, apparently there's another metal song on the album, and I'm hoping with a title like that, I wonder if this is the metal song, but also I kind of hope it's not, because I don't want to hear the second one already before we're done with part one. But anyways, all the same, here we go. Sadie Sorceress. Here we go.
Okay, here goes. Sound like metal already.
Yeah.
Okay. This is Sadie Sorceress. Sadie's lady, Miss Sadie, she's wild like a witch. We'll fight a critic. Smoking greenies and drinking titties and confetish. She's a role of play to skate a masquerading squabble and gobble, eats blood and trouble. Metal's in the middle of it. She throws a head. Dragon stay on knapsack. They're a pelt of Macedon. Brings it on his carry-on. Shot like farmers and living nonpartisan. Leviathan cardigan. Elegant artisan. Concealing her identity as an evil entity. Anti-sanctity in a facility quantity. Nightshade bringing death commander. Have a gander. That Ambrose? Poisonous like buttercup. She's dressing
up to fuck shit up. Yeah, I think so.
Oh, Stu. Okay, it's Stu. See why this album might be divisive. What is happening? Man,
who went first? You went first last time, right?
you go ahead.
All right. So I'm gonna just say this right off the top, hats off to these guys for giving this a shot. It's hands down why I keep coming back to these guys, because my own personal ethic is like, hey, if you got an idea, give it a shot, try it out, you know, see what happens. And the fact that they thought, like, let's try rap and let's see if we can pull this off, you know, we got this kind of idea, even if it's a dumb idea, go ahead and try it and see what happens. And, you know, that was interesting. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my goodness. Oh man. Sorry. I don't know what to say. I'd rather listen to the other one. What was that? This other song. Yeah, like I don't know. And these guys are great. Now people are gonna hate the channel. Now maybe I don't know. Look, they're talented guys. But this, like, were they trying to be funny? Like, are they having fun? Listen. Okay, wait. Slow down. They're having fun. I get it. Don't get me wrong. They're having fun playing Gaia. So let me rephrase it. They probably had a blast playing Gaia. Okay. Mm-hmm. So let me rephrase the question. Like, but with Gaia, they weren't pretending to be metal guys. They were metal guys. This was, like, if you were to show Gaia for the first time to a metal fan and they never heard of King Gizzard before, they're like, holy, these guys are freaking awesome. These guys are.
Yeah.
Who are these metal guys? I've never heard of these guys before. Then if you're to show this song to a hip hop fan,
check out this hip hop. Come on, man, check it out. Shady songs,
right? You know, I see where you're going with that. Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. So good on them, and we're losing people in our Discord because I'm making. Anyways, look, it's not boring. I get it. They're talented people. All the same. Again, this is another song where I'm like, just give me another Gaia song. Like, that's where this is the selfish Ryan coming out, where it's like, if you guys are going to release a 20 song album, an hour and a half album, did we need this? Is this like, what are we doing here? You're having fun. It's your choice, but it's just fun. I understand that. I agree. This is just me. I'm like, life's short.
So I'm going to disagree with you on this one.
That's fine. By all means.
Just because they wouldn't be King Gizzard without Sadie Sorceress. Honestly.
Okay, but we haven't had this type of discussion before with previous, like, not to this degree. So,
well, but okay, so just go back to Sketches of Brunswick East. That particular one we didn't like, but you know, it's their willingness to explore different genres that keeps me coming back for more. I am not going to go back and listen to the song again. And I would suspect not a lot of people will be like, oh yeah, I got to hear Sadie Sorceress. But without it on the album, and just like I said on the last one, without it existing, it speaks to me to their integrity as musicians, that they continually try stuff, even if it sucks. So, me.
Okay. Yeah, I hear what you're saying, and that's. I guess if this song didn't exist, the album wouldn't be weaker. And I will say the album might have been stronger. Let's pretend the song didn't exist on the album. Oh, I'm sure. Wondering if some of those 5 out of 10, 6 out of 10 reviews maybe would be bumped up a notch because they just wouldn't have to sit through it.
I guess. Yeah. I guess.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. All right. What's the next one?
Okay, next one.
Hey, let's pretend we're Beastie Boys for one song, guys. Yeah! Okay, what's the next one?
Evilest Man.
Well, people are calling me now, I'm sure.
Cool.
Yeah, start. Sounds like The Who. A little bit of The Who there.
A little bit, yeah. Oh yeah.
There we go. Now they're back.
jam in a while. It's great.
Yeah.
Misinformation around me. I have no faith in what I read. The tabloids and the TV screen. I see it just as clear as thee.
Extended outro there.
So of course that intro and outro I did say at the beginning, it reminded me of the Who. But okay, so that song, at first I thought, oh, is this the metal song, you know, because it started off that way, but then it didn't go there. But then it kind of tied it up at the end a little bit metal sounding. But it was more rock and roll, which is fantastic. Let's just be honest here. That song is amazing. That song is the top tier. King Gizzard, they are...
They're back.
They are back, baby. So it'd almost be interesting to create a like 10-song power list from this album. I'm not there yet, but it'd be, maybe I'll do it at the end. Or, you know, if they were told, look, guys, you got to pick 10 songs from this album. Make it. I think you could make a 10 out of 10 album, if that makes sense. Anyways, right now, that would definitely be in that. You'd have to put this in Gaia and probably the Dripping Tap. Then you got...
what's the other one? Well, anyway.
That might be something we could do at the end, is we pick our top 10 songs from the album. And that would be your greatest hit from the album, so to speak. Make it an A+. That song was top tier, amazing. I mean, the subject matter, Rupert Murdoch's... multi billionaire. He's 91 years old, one of those creepy guys. He's married on a sixth marriage to Jerry Hall, who is the ex-wife of Mick Jagger, and she says can't wait, you know, please die. Anyway, so that being said, I love the lyrics in this, talking about you can't trust anything you see or hear in the media. Yes, that's true. Even though it's all in high def now, I like that idea that, oh, look, it's in high def, but the news is still fake. Or misleading. Always has an agenda, and I don't believe anything that has an agenda. But that being said, top tier, A+, 10 out of 10, amazing song. Probably, boy, in many ways, even though I love Gaia because I love pounding metal, you know, I would say this is a better song than Gaia because this is better. It just has more going on and they do it well. So job well done. This is probably my favorite song on the album thus far.
Okay. Very, very high praise from you. I think this is the most King Gizzard song on the album. There was, we got little sounds from like, even like early King Gizzard there. Some of that echoey guitar that Stu often uses. But it's more than that. It's more like the evolution of King Gizzard because there's sounds from, I think, almost every album in there other than the microtonal guitar. Like, I didn't hear any of that in there. Other than that, I found that, I just got a note from about my son. He's playing rugby right now.
All right, well, Nathan, your son's okay. We'll continue sort of that weird edit if people are wondering what happened. We just took a pause, took a break. We're going to do two more songs for this part one. Long story short, we enjoyed Evilest Man, but Nathan, I don't think... Yeah, you said what you had to say on that one too, didn't you?
Yeah, just generally that it's the evolution of King Gizzard. It's them at their finest, and it's the culmination, I think, of everything that they've done. The evidence. If you want evidence of their evolution, I think that's the song.
Their growth, yeah, for sure. Again, so that was a great song. So now I get worried. I know. All right, so the next one's called The Garden Goblin.
Ooh, The Garden Goblin.
Garden Goblin, Garden Goblin.
Saxophone. It sounds like one. Okay. It's going to lead right into the next one. That's a weird song. So who's Nicholas? Nicholas Craig? Because that was one of the credits for the song.
Nicholas Craig?
Yeah, Nick Craig. Is that someone that we're supposed to know? Is that like a regular member that we're...
They're saying it's Cook Craig. It's just Cook.
Oh, it said
he goes by. Oh, Cook is his nickname, right? Nicholas Roderick Cook Craig.
KK. That's right. That's what it is. Okay. That's the only curious question I had about that song. It's kind of it's the kind of song to be on a.
Okay, but I have what's the word I'm looking for? I have a workaround that maybe enjoyed a little bit more when I imagined it this way.
Okay.
This song would be perfect. And King Gizzard, I know you're listening. Stu, I know you listen to our channel. I know that he does. I've got proof that he does. So Stu, listen to me right now. You guys have done everything. You've done metal, hip hop, jazz, pop. What you guys need to do is a children's album. You guys need to do the King Gizzard children's show.
Yeah.
Wouldn't that be amazing? Yeah. And I think if they did like video footage and the puppets and stuff, mm-hmm. I think they could have a fantastic time doing it like a children's album, a children's songs. That once I kind of made that like a children's song, like for mm-hmm. young kids to listen to with images,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
fantastic. What a lot of fun.
Yeah, I wouldn't put it past them just because I think they're in that phase of their lives right now where they're having kids. So
yeah,
because I know Butterfly 3000, one of the influences for that album was to make it kind of like more pleasant sounding, because he was going, I think Stu was especially having or had some of his first kid, or I can't remember exactly the details. The super fans will know better than I do.
Right.
But yeah. So they could absolutely pull off a kid's album. I think they absolutely could. Yeah.
So there you go. That's my Stu. When they do it, I want to get the credit that I suggested they do. You know what's going to happen. Okay. All right. This is the last one for part one. It's called Blame It on the Weather. Before we, remember Nathan, remember Milli Vanilli?
Oh, yeah. So what are you doing back?
No, that wasn't the different. That was,
that was
Girl, You Know It's True.
Girl, You Know It's True. Oh, right.
This one was Blame It on the Rain.
Yeah.
I love it. Milli Vanilli. They didn't even sing on the album. Like, that wasn't even. They were just the face, the handsome face of the poor schlubs who were singing in the studio. Oh my god. How embarrassing is that?
Mm-hmm.
Oh man. All right, here we go.
All right, Blame It on the Weather.
Blame It on the Weather.
Ambrose.
Yep. Cowbell there?
Yeah. Man, nobody sings like Ambrose.
I love it.
I like this drum beat.
Okay, so I love ahead. Ambrose. I love Ambrose. Love everything he does. He does have such a wonderful, unique voice. I love his style. So when I see him in my head when he's singing, he's just such a cool guy. He's my favorite member of the band by far. And so he just elevates anything, even something that might seem subpar or just like not revolutionary. He just makes it special. Does that with this song. And this song has a really 1970s recording style to it. You know, when it almost sounds like, is it distorted in my ears? Like, it's not that loud, but everything sounds kind of like they have the speakers on a little bit too loud.
Yeah.
And also, like, at the end there, they have a little choir, like a lot of multi-voices choir singing. It's just a fun 70s groovy I have no idea what they're talking about.
Yeah,
so I love that song. It was fun, a lot of fun.
King Gizzard does that a lot with I've noticed that with their vocals, they kind of they crank the volume so that it distorts, and it's kind of a staple, I think, of King Gizzard's stuff is to have that that happened. The other question I keep having, like, I was listening to that song and I was like, oh, this is such a good song, and there was like the hints of a solo that started up there, and then it went away, and I thought, oh, what a great, like, I'm gonna keep, you know, banging this drum every time it comes up. Is King Gizzard can absolutely handle doing solos. I know both Joey and Stu are, you know, very accomplished soloists that could pull it off. And I'd love to hear them explore that a little bit more. They're probably reluctant for the sake of, it's sometimes a bit cliche, and they are not a cliche band by any stretch. So I'm sure that's partly what holds them back, is they're like, but if we do that, that's like every song. So I'd love to see them explore that more and find out how to solo King Gizzard style, if that makes sense, to like pull off a solo that isn't cliche, but still kind of fits into the song. So yeah.
Great. Well, there you go. That's part one. Hope everyone enjoyed it. If you like what we're doing, support us on our Patreon. You can just be a little whelper, and for a couple bucks a month, you're just saying, hey, thanks guys, thanks for bringing out all this content. Everything we're doing now is free. We're not doing anything, we're not charging anyone to we're doing what we want to do. But if you like what we're doing, we ask you to support us on Patreon. If not, at the very least, join us on Discord. You can watch this stuff live and join the chat like these wonderful people have done today. So thank you so much.
And then the good thing is, if you want to see stuff that, you know, as we record it and you missed it, it always goes up onto our Patreon and you can watch it there. So
right away. It goes on there right away. Yeah. All right. This is part two of Omnium Gatherum. I would say, Nathan, for the first half, part one, we greatly and, like, for the most part, enjoyed all the songs very much. So there was a couple, I would say three, I think, out of the eight or whatever, three that were kind of, okay. Mm-hmm. I think it was three. I don't remember the names, but I think three is about the number. What do you think?
Yeah, two or three. Yep.
Yeah. Which, for any album, that's a pretty good average. So I can see why this album was a little bit divisive with some fans. It's what I've heard. I haven't gone on Reddit or anything to see what people are saying, but just people on our Discord have said it is a bit of a divisive album.
Mm-hmm.
I want to mention, though, this was from, he just joined our Discord. This was from Murdoch. He said, he asked, like, don't you like the Beastie Boys? You know, regarding our Sadie song? Was that what it was called?
Sorceress
Sadie?
Yeah.
Sadie the Sorceress? Sorceress the Sadius? So he goes, and yes, I do. I do quite enjoy Beastie Boys. You and I were teenagers when they were at their peak. You and I listened to them all the time. So very familiar with them, enjoy them. But just because, now I didn't say during that song, I don't think we mentioned but it did remind me of Beastie Boys, and because it's, you know, white people doing hip hops, and their little bit of vocal effect kind of sounded like, you know, their Check It Out album. I forget what it's called now off the top of my head. But anyway, so that being said, just because I like the Beastie Boys, A, doesn't mean I like old Beastie Boys songs. So keep that in mind. And this is where fandom kind of becomes a little bit, not that Murdoch was doing this, but where people who are fans of any band, they don't allow that band to suck at anything ever. And I have been fans of bands for 30-40 years. Like, I'm a big Bruce Springsteen fan. I've been a fan of his since 1985. Okay, it's been almost 40 years. He's got some snoozers, and I'm allowed to say that as a fan. There's songs I don't listen to, there's songs I'll never listen to again till the day I die. But he's one of my top, but I would die to see him live again in concert. So you can be a fan of a band, but I think it's a little ridiculous when fans of bands don't allow criticism. So I'm not saying Murdoch's doing that, but just I think that song might get some pushback when it gets live on YouTube. But anyways, I just wanted to say, like, so yes, I'm a Beastie Boys fan, and it reminded me of a Beastie Boys song, but that's the thing. If Beastie Boys had done that song, it would have been a bit of a weaker Beastie Boys song is what I'm getting at. Okay.
Yeah. They even acknowledge, there's an article I posted in our Discord that goes through basically King Gizzard's attempt at this album and how some of these are experiments. Not as like full blown, like, you know, completely, you know, gone through the ringer kind of tracks where they've all sat down and like, is this what do we got to cut or change? And, you know, that kind of cutting room floor stuff that often happens with a larger album or with a bigger release. Whereas this one has that kind of experimental vibe to it. So back to what I was saying on that particular song, it still fits on the album, in my opinion, only because I think it's the kind of stuff that King Gizzard is well known for. And if they didn't have stuff like that on the album, I'd be kind of like, oh, okay, it's just all a rock album, or it's all of this album, or whatever, right?
So that's fair.
Yeah.
You're. And my argument back for that is, again, is that song didn't exist, we would never be the wiser.
Yeah, I guess.
Yeah, we wouldn't be the wiser. That's all. And it doesn't mean it's not brave or not fun, and people like it. So it worked for some people, absolutely. We'll wrap this up. I'm a big GNR fan. You and I were big GNR fans, of course, when we released User Illusion 1 and 2. Those albums are incredible, but there's stinkers on those albums. And you could almost make those two albums into one incredible 14-track album if you combine just the best 14 tracks out of the 30 tracks that both provide. Mm-hmm. That's all I was saying. Like, again, it was kind of a bloated experiment, and I think that's what Axl was doing. Those, it was kind of like, I just want to produce music, and it is all these different themes and sounds from those albums. Those albums aren't consistent in how they sound. There's ballads and country and all this different stuff. So yeah, this is King Gizzard's version of that idea of, like, they're throwing a lot at, you know, a lot of the kitchen soup, as they would say, or the gumboot soup here is happening, where we're getting different sounds. Not everything sticks. Okay, what's the next one we got here?
It's called Persistence.
People have to be persistent when they watch our channel.
Oh, every day. Every.
Are you recording? I hope you're recording all that. Are you recording
all that? Just kidding. You know, it's, of course it's recording.
Well, whatever. We'll just have to bitch and moan all over again. Okay. Remind me to tell you who this sounds like right away.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so you said to remind you who it sounds like.
Yeah, and people are going to probably say, meh. Remind me of Jane's Addiction. The sound, the guitar, that heavy bass with the acoustic guitar and the high vocal. And if you were to speed that up just a smidgen and put in Perry Farrell's voice, you would have a, I think you would have a Jane's Addiction song.
Oh, yeah, that's a good call. I can hear it. Yeah, I can hear that. I would imagine that song, like we're making our way through the Butterfly 3000 videos. And one of the things in those videos they do a lot of is animation. And I imagine that song would have some animation that like,
right.
Let's see if this car can fly. And then, I don't know, maybe a combination of the gang inside of a car. It's like animation with them flying and I don't know.
No, yeah, I can see that fitting on Butterfly, but I love the deep bass sound, almost like a not a drum track, but almost that sounds like synthetic almost. It's got this kind of a dance beat sound to it, but you know it's a real drum. But what I like about that song, it's a nice crisp, clear song, nice beat, deep bass groove, and they did the right thing by making it just like just over 3.5 minutes long. That's a song that would suffer from dragging out too much. King Gizzard does that sometimes where they go, hey, we got a good thing going here, let's double the song length. That was good. It's a nice tight song, nice and groovy for the they've done a few of these songs on this album, that type of sound. So obviously that's part of what they're going for, that sound. I don't know if that's the direction they're going in, because they've been leaning towards that on this album a little bit. They did it with Butterfly. It's kind of this danceability song sound to it, kind of very just like a clean, crisp, groovy sound. So it sounded great, and that is definitely a song I would listen to again. I like that one. I give it a solid C plus B for sure.
Okay, so to rate it. In that article that I was referencing earlier, they talk about this song that's about to come up. It's the second. Oh. It's the second hip hop song on the album. So
we gotta say okay. Oh boy. You should that's fine that you warned
me. I'm sorry.
They did two hip hop. Interesting. They did two metal songs too. So
that
one hasn't come. Don't tell me anyone in the chat. Don't tell me when the metal one's coming.
Okay, so. I didn't mean to spoil it, but
that's okay. You didn't, no, I mean it would take me 2 seconds. Okay. Well, I'll be more honestly. The other one just hit me as it hit me. That's what reaction channels are for, right? That's what you react to. Hey, this best part's coming up. I want you to see how you react. Well, don't tell me. You don't want to prepare somebody. But okay, so
I don't know if it's any good or not. I just know.
No, you haven't heard the song. You just know. Okay, so the Grim Reaper. I was actually had a feeling the Grim Reaper was the metal song just by the title. But again, wrong. The titles have fooled me twice in the hip hop songs. So. Okay.
Okay. Here goes.
There you go. Yeah. Sounds like a meaty file, like a video game.
Yeah. I'm a Grim Reaper, chimney sweeper, gatekeeper. Running faster than a cheetah, praying on the weaker. Got you in my point blank range, is a day game. I'm coming at you like a hurricane. You're a scavenger, scratching a rap for scraps, sipping on gas, just a lot of matches. Get Ambrose rapping?
Yep. Waiting for the ultimatum to be handed down. From above, never move the muscle, never do the fuck. Music much better on this one. If it's bad for business, in the business from the hell house, slipping out stitches of the stitches, then there's gotta be more than justice in discussion. For the ones causing the corruption, are you having an extension crisis? Time is crisis, and advisors analyze it. Break it down into small increments to repent.
Do on the flute, I bet.
Good call. Rotted flesh or the wrist, the Grim Reaper cashes the check. Rotted flesh or the wrist, the Grim Reaper cashes the check. According to Wikipedia, it's not the flu. Heaven sent a silhouette of many wicked men. Feel us reckoning, thinking they're the most powerful that ever been. I begin to comprehend the arrogance. Put it in the top of cranium.
Same song.
Well, I know. I wonder if it bleeds in. Okay.
It probably bleeds in a little. Okay, so a couple of things about that song. And this is from that article again, and this is kind of influencing me. Not that it says anything about this particular song, but it definitely, Stu talks about how Ambrose, and he calls him Ambi.
Oh, that's cute.
he's into hip-hop. Like, he's probably got a bunch of tracks that he's recorded, and the person interviewing them is like, so are you guys gonna do like a hip-hop album? And Stu's like, yeah, maybe someday, but these are just like, we're just experimenting with stuff, we're not like, you know, we're not getting serious and like, oh yeah, we should totally go this way. It's just them testing things out. And because Ambrose likes, you know, hip-hop a lot, it's like you said earlier about how you like it when bands give each other chances to kind of, you know, test out the stuff that they like and mm-hmm. get a chance in the limelight. And so that this is, I'm guessing, the band's saying to Ambrose, like, yeah, sure, let's do this. Why not? Yeah. So okay. It's kind of cool that the article specifically talks about how Stu was supporting, you know, this, just testing it out.
Okay. What did you think of the song?
Oh, sorry. It's good. As far as like compared to the last one, I liked it more. And it's more King Gizzard-y, if that makes sense. It's got a little more of the King Gizzard flavor. Some of the, almost like the microtonal sounds there. You could hear some of that there. I guess it wasn't a flute. There was some guy named Heinz Funk that was credited as one of the writers of that song. I don't know who that is. Maybe that's Ambrose's hip-hop name. I don't know.
Hmm. Yeah, according to Wikipedia, I think the instrument might have been the baglama.
Oh.
Glama?
Oh, okay. I don't know what that is.
Was played by Joe. No, neither do I, but it might have been that kind of Eastern sound that we're hearing.
Hmm. Okay.
You know, it was like a snake charmer.
Sure. But
it doesn't mean Wikipedia's right, but Stu... It's funny, I guess Joey also plays the flute.
Hmm.
Yeah, he plays the flute on track 12, actually, the next track. Hmm. Now, it'd be presumptuous for people to think that Ryan wouldn't have enjoyed the Grim Reaper. I totally enjoyed that. It was much different experience. Again, I like the Beastie Boys, and I like there's great hip-hop songs out there. Like, those aren't, it's not a genre that you and I hate. It's just, we don't gravitate towards it. It's not our wheelhouse. But a good song is a good song if it's got a fun sound and mm-hmm. fun lyrics and good vocals. Like, I know Eminem is very popular, but I enjoy a lot of his stuff, right? Mm-hmm. I just do. I like the way he does this thing, right? So,
what?
So, nothing. I was going to say a joke, but I don't want to say the joke because...
I can tell when you're holding back. It's hilarious.
It doesn't matter. Anyway, so the Grim Reaper, I really enjoyed this one. And I think one of the criticisms I had for the previous hip-hop song was called Sadie Sorcery Song Dance. What was it called again? Sadie Shag.
I think it's Sadie the Sorceress.
Sadie Shags in the Shack. What was it called? Anyway, so I think with that one, I asked the question, were they being goofy on purpose? Now we know they can be silly and stuff. I get it. And I guess mission accomplished. If the answer is yes, well, then mission accomplished.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't find it funny. If the answer is no, then it's kind of embarrassing, but it was kind of like, ugh, it didn't work. Mm-hmm. Here's an example of, okay, they weren't being silly here. If that makes sense. This was a real attempt at a hip-hop sound. Just like you said, Nathan, with that King Gizzard flair, that Eastern flute sound or whatever it was, the snare drum was nice and like it had that King Gizzard snare sound. Mm-hmm. So it was just basically almost like Ambrose just riffing on a mic. And so it sounded more organic and more King Gizzard-like in the hip-hop form. So I guess, yeah, I'd be thinking it'd be great if King Gizzard did a hip-hop album. And if this song is an indication of what they could do when they're not... Look, we're being silly with hip-hop. I think they're better being... We're being King Gizzard with hip-hop, and that's an example. I think that's what this song does. It's like, yeah.
It was well said. Well said, Ryan.
Oh, like, thank you. Yeah. It would be presumptuous of people to think that I don't like hip-hop. Okay, what's the next song, Nathan?
Oh... Well, it just so happens to be that the next song is called Presumptuous.
It's because Eminem's, Eminem's white. Okay, so what's in...
Is that what the joke was?
It was just going to be a joke. So like, I really like his rapping. Anytime I say I like Eminem, I always feel like, crap, why do I like the one white rapper? it's not true. I like a lot of rappers. I have a lot of white rapper friends. Okay, let's... All right, it doesn't matter. Nobody watches our channel. It doesn't matter. None of this matters.
Oh, boy.
None of this matters. None of this matters.
Okay, let's go. I don't know anything about the song. Let's just listen.
It's presumptuous. I think you would.
This one sounds a little like... So presumptuous, with Don G. Oh, what's that band?
That's Ambrose again.
Oh, yeah.
Singing a little lower there. Lower tone. So
presumptuous, falling at your feet.
It's like R&B type sound. So presumptuous, don't agree with your negativity. That was like disco. Eggshell in my stepping stones.
Kindred spirits at a crossroads. Bongos.
Me
too.
Yeah. 1970s, man. Here we go.
Santana a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah,
noise. Hey, party in the background. Hey. I love that. Hey, party sounds in the background. Very 70s.
Like a funk undertone to it. That bass. Yeah, I'm gonna take this one first.
Sure.
So,
what?
Yeah. That's a great song. That's got like stuff that I don't know if we've ever really heard in that combination in King Gizzard before. Like certainly that, like we were saying, the Santana sound, the like older guitar, the funky bass, the like. Oh, that's what my thought was. Sorry. I'm like,
go ahead.
I had this thought that came earlier and I kind of let it go.
Take your time.
These guys are fantastic. So each one of them is a musician in his own right. I've been going through a lot of our old reactions, and something I said way early on about King Gizzard was that they're a musician's band. And I still stand by that. They not only are they a musician's band, meaning like if you're a musician, you kind of like this stuff. They're also all like brilliant musicians. The fact that they can do this kind of a thing where they give Ambrose time, they, you know, give Joey time, you know, each member of the band kind of gets to do what they want. It's phenomenal, you know. I'm amazed that they're still together, if that makes sense. Like
We've talked about this before where
like egos often get in the way of bands, right? Where somebody's who's in charge and who's running the show. Right. The fact that there's so many of them that are so talented and they haven't fallen apart is amazing.
Yeah, agreed. Totally agree. Yeah, we've mentioned that before. We got so much talent in the band and everyone could almost have their own album.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And, but maybe that's why they release so much, because maybe instead of all these separate like side projects, they just do all the projects together.
Yeah.
You know, they're creative. They just get their creative ideas out there together as a band, which is awesome. It's a smart business plan too.
Sure. And I think they're better together, to be honest. Yeah.
Well, most bands are.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, most bands, you know, until very, very few solo acts are better than the album or bands they came from, if that makes sense. Like, yeah. Nobody's talking about Robert Plant's solo albums.
Yeah.
You know what
except
I mean?
Like Eric Clapton. That's a exception.
Some. I said some.
Yeah.
Most. Yeah. Very few solo artists are better and bigger than Michael Jackson is an example.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, he's a better solo artist. anyways, we get a whole debate about
anyway,
that.
Anyway,
it's rare. Before people, here's an example. Yeah, it's rare, comparatively speaking. Okay. All right. Next song is called Predator X, and I'm guessing this is the metal song. It's got to be with that title. It's got to be.
Okay, we'll find out.
All right. Especially look at these lyrics now. It's gonna be, those are metal lyrics. Oh, there you go.
That would be presumptuous to think that it's.
Predator,
Man, this feels like garage metal.
Yeah, this is Kill 'Em All. This is Kill 'Em All spawn area.
Yeah.
We the Four Horsemen ride.
Come to make your life.
Oh, that'd be so amazing in a concert.
Oh,
right
yeah.
There. Oh, the crowd. Yeah. Oh, the crowd. Oh, another solo. Dual guitar. Dual solo.
Man, the time changes in this. That was such a like blast from the past. Of like, it sounded so much like old Metallica. Not so much. I shouldn't say so much. It echoes of it.
No, it totally reminded me of Kill 'Em All sound. That's the Kill 'Em All sound. Yeah. If you were to take that tone alone without the singing, let's say, hey, check out this like lost riff from Kill 'Em All. They just released it on YouTube. It's a lost James Hetfield riff from Kill 'Em All.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone would be like, oh yeah, mm-hmm. cool, yeah. You know what I mean? Like, you wouldn't have thought that you're crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes and no. They'd be like, oh, what are these different time signatures that don't always just line up to 4/4? That would be right. The part that would stand out, you know? Yeah, but...
How come Lars is a drum? Okay, all right. so far with the second side, or sort of part two, it's not really a second side, but mm-hmm. we've seen the second hip-hop song, we've seen... the second metal song, we've seen like the second like groovy, funky 70s song. Mm-hmm. I'm finding the second half, it repeats the first half, but it's a little bit better.
I'm gonna disagree with you on it, only because recently I went back and listened to not the entire first half, but certainly my top favorites of that first half. I already have. And
I'm talking about the ones that are compared, like the comparative ones.
I see. Kind of like the
just those. I mean, maybe just those three. Like, there's the metal. There's the metal.
So I like Gaia better than that song. Like, I like that song, but Gaia is fantastic.
It is fantastic. Of course,
the Dripping Tap is such a good song.
I'm not comparing. Would you stop crapping on my point? The point is, I wasn't talking about the Dripping Tap is like its own extended play.
Yeah.
You know, like it's by we. You know, that's a different video that we did. It's almost part zero.
Yeah. It's so true.
This is a huge album. There's so much going on. Like this should have almost been three EPs or two albums and an EP. You could almost It's just there's a gargantuan. This is a massive undertaking.
Yeah, it's really strong throughout, with the occasional kind of like song, but again. We can get lost in the weeds here if we keep going with that.
Yeah. Let's just listen to music and not talk about it. That's what reaction channels are.
Well, that's a great idea. Why don't we do that with the next song?
Yeah. Can you imagine? Yeah. Let's bob our heads.
Red smoke.
Red smoke.
Mm. Ambrose.
Yeah, it's a very Ambrose heavy album. I love. A jazzy feel. The trust is slow, but the pop hat fast.
Yeah. Reminds me of Doors.
On the storm. React to the Doors. Thoughts.
Kind of echoes back to do you remember their the Western one that they do with remember the one with the storyline and
yeah
I think it's Ambrose's dad that's voicing it the sound kind of reminded me of that a little bit but also I love the effect on Ambrose's voice that they're using just how they're processing his voice for that. Like just, I think he had a couple of times where they're using some kind of a pass filter where they get him harmonizing with himself and you can hear this kind of, it just, I don't know. It had the kind of a sound. What I thought mostly about this song generally is I think I would like this more and more after reading or listening to it, a couple of times. It made me think, like, I gotta listen to this one again. Like, it was starting to grow on me, but it was it got me intrigued to listen multiple times, if that makes sense. Yeah.
Well, I love Ambrose. I love what he does. I love his style, his swagger, his voice, his vocals. And that's the highlight of this song. The music itself is like, yeah, okay. It's okay. But I think the highlight for me on this song was definitely Ambrose's vocal work. I love how he sings. I love how he sounds. A very like 1960s, you know, we talk about the Doors. They're obviously the influence there. Speaking of which, Nathan, you brought up the Western album that King Gizzard did. I believe it was their second album, if my King Gizzard knowledge is any indication of anything. I don't know. I think it was their second album. But anyways, if people are wondering, well, you guys should react to that, put it on YouTube. Well, we would love to, but it got fully blocked on YouTube. But it's available on our Patreon if you want to watch that reaction. Is that not true, Nathan?
It is not yet uploaded. I am just getting into the 2020 stuff, so...
No, I believe it's I believe it's blocked on YouTube is what I'm saying.
So, oh yeah.
It got blocked. It got blocked or rejected. What a weird. I don't know why that was, but anyways, that's one of the few albums that got blocked and our dispute got rejected. So it's available on our Patreon or soon to be. Anyways, okay. All right. Next one.
Okay. Next is called
Candles.
Candles.
Candles on the wind. A Stu song. He wrote it.
Oh.
Totally. The last two songs are just Stu McKenzie.
We got a lounge. Kind of a song.
Xylophone. Thank you.
with the candles.
Be a Stew song without a woo.
You must be a Ric Flair fan.
Woo! Woo!
You're a Ric Flair, the wrestler?
I know who you're referencing. Woo! I don't know specifically.
You're, he does that sound every time. Woo.
Okay.
Alright.
Oh. The last song is called The Funeral.
Okay.
All the lyrics are The Funeral.
What are they? Oh, is that it? Okay. All right. So, yeah, not a good song.
The last song?
Yeah. That was a good song.
It was kind of a...
Like even the chorus, the candles chorus, there's a reason why I'm kind of making fun of it. It's silly. Like it doesn't sound cool. Again, this example, this is an example of we can play instruments. Look, that's what it felt like. Like, yeah,
yeah.
Not a good song. Like, I don't know what to say about that one. Like, if you go put on Gaia, go put on Gaia right now. You know what I mean? You go listen to Gaia after listening to that song. And this album, I think this is the problem. We said this at the beginning. I feel like there's like 5 to 7 songs we could probably take off, and you'd have a freaking boom, 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 boom album. But not my favorite song. Nathan, you?
Nope. And I know that we're gonna get the like freak out fans of King Gizzard that are like, everything they do is amazing. That will disagree with us. Yeah. So
they got 30 albums, one song can't be bad.
Yeah. And one song on a like that's literally titled a gathering of, you know, it's like Gumboot Soup and this one are basically related to each other. So is it okay that a few of these are a little bit like, oh, that was an interesting attempt?
I'm not going to, don't defend ourselves. People, they can splooge on their own all over they want on the album if they want to. They don't have, like, that's fine. Like, I don't have to do it for them. You know what I mean? This is our listening experience. This is what we think.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
It was a very good song. It was boring. I was actually kind of bored. I was like, okay. Nothing exciting about it. Stu, you can do better.
Yeah. Well, let's see if he does better.
Well, I don't know what this one's going to be. This is just says The Funeral 1,000 times. So it's either going to be really catchy and fun.
Or it's going to go, The Funeral.
Bro.
The Funeral.
The Funeral.
Okay, right. Let's give it a listen.
Western style you're talking about before.
Mm-hmm. That like Eastern flavor guitar. Which I found out is one of the influences on Latin music.
Kind of like an outro song.
I like this. Hoping it built up.
like an outro song. Yeah. And then you have to listen to it again. Don't you gotta listen? Yeah, you gotta. It goes into the next. Yeah, it goes into the next. I knew. All right.
Let me close this. Just a second. Let me close this.
Okay. Sorry. Yeah, close it. All right.
Ooh, hang on. Hang on. Okay. Go.
All right. Overall, people are going to think we're. I think. Here's the thing. If you come to our channel to watch our reactions and you want us to be a vacuum, then we can do that. We'll sing and dance for you just to placate people's feelings. However, I think you and I were fair, more than fair, to the songs that weren't very strong.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And King Gizzard is an amazing band. And often, any of your... Think of a favorite actor. A favorite actor of yours who you've seen them knock it out of the park in a certain movie. And then they come out with something like, oh, come on. We know you're better than that. That's all it is. So sometimes you're... As any artist, you know certain artists are better than what they're doing. But for the most part, this album, of course, it's an A. Like it, mm-hmm. the song, when they worked, they were amazing. Like mm-hmm. that's mm-hmm. like the Gaia and Predator X, and I those are the two metal songs. The other hip hop song, the Grim Reaper, mm-hmm. and then all the other classic or sort of jazz sounding, dance sounding songs were great, and they were like how Butterfly should have sounded. So this album, in many ways, is an amazing. I love it. I probably, if I were to take out the songs I wasn't crazy about, it'd be my top five.
Mm. Yeah. That's where I definitely agree with you. My stance on it is just a little bit different from yours, mm-hmm. in that. The ones that don't work on the album still, for me, allow me to say, like, yeah, but that's King Gizzard, right? From my sure. perspective, that's how I see King Gizzard, is they kind of have to keep on having some duds so that they stay truer to themselves. What I can't stand is when bands just, it's like, nope, we only have to put out, like, gems every single album, and that'd be great. It'd be awesome. Expecting bands to be able to put out that high level of content on every single album, I think, is beyond expectation. I love that they're so prolific in their stuff. So the fact that they've tried these things out, didn't work so well, it just means that they're just going to keep on, you know, improving their craft over time is my expectation with them. And so I don't mind that some of those weren't so good. I won't listen to them again, to be honest. Right. But I still am kind of like, that's King Gizzard. There's stuff on the other albums that I don't listen to, because yeah. I'm like, it's not as good as some of their better stuff.
Life is short. I'm at the point where I'm past midlife.
No.
Pretty much past midlife, and
yes,
like I'm not living to 92 or 4, right? So I'm past midlife. Mm-hmm. It's okay to listen to the songs that are good.
Mm-hmm.
It's okay to say, hey, I'm just gonna listen to the songs that make me tap my feet and bang my head, you know. So. But that was it's a great album.
Mm-hmm.
So people at me and say that Ryan, you didn't. No, it's a great album. I'm saying, if I could, what's the word, to cut some of the fat, you know, we just have a lean, mean fight machine album. I'd have to go through it again to get the titles of all the songs, but I could put mm-hmm. together mm-hmm. an album that most Gizzard fans would be. Of course, there's always one. I love that one. Okay, stop it. Mm-hmm. But anyways, mm-hmm. I think mm-hmm. at the end of the day, if the ones that we didn't like that much, if they didn't exist, let's pretend in our philosophical experiment, let's say those songs didn't exist,
uh-huh.
people would be raving about this album. I think this album would be not mixed, is what I'm getting at. I think sure. you can make a perfect King Gizzard album if you trim the fat.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So take that for what it is. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Well, that is our review and reaction to King Gizzard's Omnibus Gigantuum.
I love it when you purposely butcher the names. Anyway, yeah.
All right.
We enjoyed that. So hopefully significantly.
Yeah, we enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you like our stuff and want to see more stuff, or just want to say, hey, guys, thanks for doing that for free. You know, this was us doing it for you and for us. This is free. But if you want to throw a couple of bucks our way, it's a lot cheaper than what it used to be. Mm-hmm. Send us a couple of bucks on Patreon, and we appreciate that. So if not, that's cool. We do it because we'd like to listen to this music. So thank you so much.
Yeah. And hope to see you on the next one.